person in a group of people changed the whole damn system. We here honoring a person who went forth, he got people, and they got people to come out of the office. So first off, thank all y'all for being here. One of the most important reasons that this was created is that this is first and foremost a black issue. What has happened is that the movement has sort of been co-opted and turned into this sort of all lives matter thing, when truthfully, in this culture, all lives don't really matter. So what we see is we had deaths happening on TV. What we see is these deaths of these young black men who are killed specifically, and people like really don't give a shit. And when we get up and we resist and all these things, we get like these movements and these like uprisings that happen, and then people turn these uprisings and this like these acts of revolution into, they say, well, oh, everybody out here was looting, everybody out here was just out here to cause trouble. So rather than hearing that these were lives that were lost, people just don't care. And so what happens is the movement gets co-opted, and so instead of talking about the real problems, people talk about everything else. So we're never talking about the fact that black men are being killed. And aside from that, another reason why this is really, really important is in the spirit of Dr. King. Dr. King actually was somebody who opposed white supremacy, war, and poverty. He was someone who did lots of work and whose movement was built and led by women. Black women are incredibly neglected in this struggle. Black queer people are incredibly neglected in these struggles. And so what happens is you have black women and queers and queer people of color and people of color in general who are organizing these movements and organizing these rallies and all these different things. And we don't get seen and we don't get heard, and we're the ones who end up dead in the street. So this being the time in which MLK, Dr. King, his birthday was yesterday, and Monday we'll celebrate his birthday as like a national holiday. But in honoring his legacy coming here, I thought that we needed to use this time to honor the legacy of other people, because the movement wasn't just him. He wasn't even necessarily the most important person. He was just the most public and prominent person. And that's what people forget. Everybody here is a Dr. King or an Ella Baker, or, you know, if you're revolutionary, a Che or a Huey or a Malcolm or a Layla, like, everybody here is that. And so, like, that's what we have to recognize. Another thing about it was everybody here right now was a vital part of that movement. There were people who looked like us. The majority of people here are people of color. Like, the people who led these movements were young people of color. Like, we look in these history books and we see, like, you know, we might see these young white activists and we might see some older people of color. Those are not the people who went to jail. Those were not the people who got killed. Those are not the people who suffered brutalities and many other things. It was young people of color. We have always been the ones most neglected and the ones who put our lives first. And the people that put their lives first are always women of color. And then a lot of times it's going to be queer people of color. So that's the purpose of this. This is a space today that I know some people, I don't know, y'all might already know. But this particular speaking event is POC-centric. And so the goal of us to have white allies today is purely for white allies to listen. And the reason why that is reparative, in that a lot of times people of color go to rallies, we don't get to talk. Cameras run to, like, some white kid who we're like, what the hell are you even here for? And the people who organize it, we stare in the mirror and say, this black kid who has an autobahn mask. And so what we're trying to bring towards is the visibility and the comfort of people of color, specifically women of color, queer people of color, black women, black queer people, and these various groups of indigenous people to come and feel comfortable speaking and making sure these voices are heard. And so with that, we're going to get started. This is my friend Jay. We got the same birthday. We're both crazy as hell. Jade is brilliant. What do you do, Jade? Just give a little bit about what you do, because I don't know what you do.
I'm not that brilliant, in my regular day-to-day, my day job is doing medical records at a long-term care facility, and by night, I'm a radical person. But I really thought it was important to come out today. I've always wanted to do something like this, and like Chaz was saying, it's always in Austin, it's always in LA, it's always in Atlanta, Dallas hardly ever does anything. We do, it's the MLK parade down by Fair Park, and that's it. You know what I'm saying? It's never anything really that, like Chance is doing, that's something that's really personal and giving people the chance to talk, because they're not going to put any of us on the news. Look how we look. Not to say that we look bad, because we look very cute today, by the way. But they're not going to put us on TV. Look how we look. They're not going to put us on TV. They're going to get the people out these buildings. They're going to get the mom, the four kids that look stereotypically correct to be on the news, and they're going to say some stuff like, oh yes, today we're honoring Dr. King and his dream, and they haven't read any, you know what I'm saying? They haven't read anything about Dr. King. They've only got what they learned in school, and that's the only thing that they know. So thank you so much for inviting me, because I really thought this was vital. I do have other things going on today, but at the same time, though, I did want to come and be a part of this, even for just for a little while, to say that I was able to do this.
And then you got to speak for us, like I said. You ready to read that?
Sure.
All right. I know you loud, so just go ahead and like when you read it.
You know, I talk in teams. All right. Me. Okay. All right. On this MLK weekend, we are gathering here in memory of his legacy. His legacy of equality, freedom, and justice. But these are only a few pieces of the foundation in which his memory stands. He not only wanted these three things for those of color just to have it, but for those of non-color to understand it. He wanted us to have a sense of self, a sense of pride, and not only in being American, but being black and American. Today we are speaking about the state of our people at this time, this decade. We are speaking about the tragedies that have come to light, the tragedies still hidden by the guard, the triumphs that no one cares about, and the statistics that define a race. And what I mean by triumphs that no one cares about, did y'all know that there were there's a group of triplet black sisters who all just graduated from Harvard? Nobody knows that, because they didn't report that in the news, did they? Nobody knows about that. Triumphs like the first African boy to get a full ride scholarship to any university, not just in this country, in the world. He is that smart. Nobody knows about that. Nobody reported about that. In school during Black History Month, we learn about the usuals, MLK, Malcolm X, Harriet Tubman, and Rosa Parks. Not many men, but definitely only a select few women. Why? Because we are still a country that looks down on women. All of our contributions to this nation, to our race, are dwindled and they're capped. For example, we don't learn about people like Dorothy Hyde, who held both bachelor and master's degrees from NYU. Quite a feat in her time, as many colleges were admitting black students only to fit a quota. In fact, she did get into more than just NYU, but they all told her, we've already filled our black quota, so no, you can't come to our college. She helped start the National Women's Political Caucus with the feminist movement, great, Gloria Steinem. She also helped implement programs and centers for the YWCA and other organizations. We don't highlight the story of Claudette Colvin, who refused to give up her seat on the bus 9 months before Rosa Parks. She was included in the landmark case of Browder versus Gale, which the Supreme Court ruled that the ban of blacks from the front of the bus were unconstitutional. They almost didn't include her. Why? Because she was labeled a troublemaker and had the nerve to get pregnant out of wedlock. These two women not only haven't been included in the approved black history lesson because their stories aren't neat, but because they are women. The civil rights movement wanted their support, but not necessarily their leadership. Yes, even amongst our gender, but black women have to work double, even for that, because of our race. And we still have the issue of not only being black, but we have the issue of being female and black, which is a double whammy. Back then, women were star watchers over their family, the TLC givers, and the comforters. But we were and always have been more. We were disciplinarians. We were fighters. We were entrepreneurs. We were trailblazers. And we were warriors. we still are those wonderful things if given the right amount of sunshine to grow. Right. By today's definitions, we are loud, angry, obnoxious, and hopelessly ignorant. We are twerkers, entertainers, and baby mamas. We are raising a generation of black women who think all that is cute, and it's attractive, and it's acceptable. How is that? Because our women don't know the real black history of women. In school, there is no lesson plan during Black History Month about Queen Nefertiti, who was so beautiful and so smart that she was elevated to the ranks of Pharaoh, as we all know, a rank only held by men and only acknowledged to be a man. And the famous bust of her that is now held in Berlin, Germany, is the most copied of all from Egypt, which is in Africa. There is no one stating for the record that though the mighty beautiful Elizabeth Taylor portrayed her, Cleopatra was not white and was one of the most cunning pharaohs in her time. When you do not tell someone their true legacy and their history, they will swallow whatever story you give. For too long, we have allowed others to tell our story. It is the same issue with our black men. We must tell them that they have been targeted in this country since the beginning. We must tell them that their legacy is not that of gang leaders, drug dealers, and pimps. Their legacy includes Amenhotep, the husband to Nefertiti, who was the founder of the first Egyptian religion that only believes in one God. They are not told of King Oba, whose net worth right now in Africa is worth over $300 million, and who is alive today. They are not told that ancient African history is human history. Without these lessons and others, we do not know who we are. We don't know our place in this country because of the continued lies and propaganda fed to us day in and day out. Now, there are some white people who say, oh my gosh, would you please stop whining about slavery and about the civil rights movement? Those days are gone. And to please stop blaming us for the actions of our great-great-grandfathers and that of other ancestors. First of all, no one is whining. We are shouting for you to not only listen but to understand. Just because the racial tensions of this time are subtle and seamless does not mean it is non-existent. Not many whites are in the streets shouting the N-word, but they are at home quietly teaching their children to be the embodiment of that subtlety, to continue that seamless operation. They may not even realize it, but it is happening. How else would I see Facebook posts from white classmates and friends that surprise and sadden me with their content and general ignorance? How could we be so divided on the issues of Eric Garner, Michael Brown, and Tamir Rice? I grew up with these seemingly enlightened, tolerant people in the suburbs. Yet as adults, it's not the same. They keep calling us thugs, animals, ignorant, stupid, laughably clueless, and entertainment. And yes, some of us are contributing to those statistics. When you come out in public, ladies, with fake everything on, 3 or 4 babies who are in need of strong maintenance and real parenting, and talking loudly about being a bad bitch, you are making us look the part they want us to play. Gentlemen, when you come out with your pants sagging down to below your knees, oversized clothing, quoting classless and stupid song lyrics as conversation, and general lack of respect for others, you are playing to the stereotype. No matter what has been said about those 3 black guys in the news, it is still a gross oversight to say those events have nothing to do with race. The basic brainwashed foundation of those officers' actions were race. Oh yes, white people, y'all have been brainwashed, hoodwinked, and bamboozled too. You think the general dislike of black people is caused by old useless information and way back actions of old. No, it is fear. That fear is what prompted your ancestors to make an entire system dedicated to the undermining of my race. That fear is why a white person's first reaction to an angry black person is kill on sight. That fear Officer Wilson felt when he shot Michael Brown. He said, that fear is what got 12-year-old Tamir Rice shot at close range by trained professional adult men. That fear is what fuels those looks, that hatred, and those statistics. We must stop letting the numbers, calculated by some white man in a room with a computer, define us. We must stop letting the history book writers soften and strip down slavery and its effects, the effects white people can't see. We must stop letting Hollywood tell us the only movies we could possibly make are about MLK, Malcolm X, Muhammad Ali, gangster flicks, and family drama. We must stop letting those subtle, seamless atrocities go unchallenged and unchecked. The new movement has arrived. The revolution is being televised. Countries around the world are in league with the cause. It is no longer about we shall overcome. It is about we shall become. We shall become teachers. We shall become educators. We shall become movers. We shall become shakers. And we shall become innovators. And I don't mean those bright few that the news reports like comic sightings. I mean it should be commonplace. It should be expected. We are still here, Dr. King. We are still fighting. And my generation will continue the legacy of greatness. My generation is the new black. Thank you. Woo! Woo!
Thank you so much for that, Jay. That was like exceedingly powerful, and I honestly, like, that needed to come from the black woman. Like, that was like true for this nation, true for this country. It's something interesting that you brought up, or you made me think about, like, as a black woman as a speaker. Is there anybody know who Elevator is? Mm-hmm. Y'all know who Elevator is? Okay. Well, Elevator was one of, like, the champions of civil and human rights during like the same era as Dr. King. And a lot of people don't know who Elevator is. Well, this woman was an incredibly dynamic speaker. This woman organized as much as he did. This woman was as much a ferocious and charismatic presence as he is. But she don't have her own day. And that's not to say that Dr. King isn't worthy of a day, because we love Dr. King and we love the sacrifices that he made in his stand against white supremacy, war, and poverty. But we need to remember the legacies of these black women, like, you know, Rose and Coretta, and what's the other sister's name you gave?
Gloria Hyde.
We need to remember these legacies. A lot of times, also in the news, we have like young black women who are killed. We have young black women who are killed. We don't see that in the news. We don't see that talked about. We don't see the violence that happens to black queer people and black women. It's completely within communities of the black community, it's completely erased in communities of white folks. There's a strong element of invisibility of black lives. Even when we die, you don't see us killed. It's pushed to the side. That shouldn't happen. Black people have lives, we exist, we have feelings. It was something so interesting that happened to me the other day, and I'm gonna share this story with y'all. Because one of the things you talked about, that Jay spoke about, was the insidious nature of racism, and how it's not necessarily somebody out in the street saying nigga, using the N-word or whatever. It can be something that's much more subtle than what we confronted with today in culture. That even I, as a black queer person, can internalize. I was online, and I was looking, just going through my feed on this site that's called The Root, which is a black media outlet or whatever, and they're like a great black media outlet. And one of the things I came across was that this guy, Floyd Mayweather, is supposed to fight another fighter. His name is Manny Pacquiao. Okay, so there's a couple things that like really shocked me about this situation, or about my reaction to this. The first thing I did when I saw that Floyd was fighting Manny, and I was like, Floyd will win. And I was like, hold on, wait. Why did I instantly assume that Floyd would win? I was like, it was a gut reaction. I don't really know that much about Floyd Mayweather, and I'm gonna tell you what I do know about him. I don't know that much about him. I don't know much about Mandy, so I was like, why did I assume that Floyd would win? And what I came to the conclusion of is that even as a black person, what I have internalized, and I'm going to connect this to how police brutality happens, what I have internalized is that black is instantly associated with having a lack of feeling and brutality. So even me as a black person, I perceive black people as aggressive. I see black women and I think like, oh, she's just angry. Or black men, people who look like me, and I view them in a certain light. So I'm always like, you can't tell me that if I as a black person have internalized these things, that I don't, there are not other groups of people who internalize things like this. So I really came to a strong sort of, like I said, awareness of how black people are perceived in society. And that's something that we have to be careful of. Specifically on the issue of black women, we have to make sure that we're not vilifying black women, and that when black people or black women are speaking up and angry, we need to make sure that they're being listened to. When black queer people are speaking, we need to make sure that people like myself are being listened to, and that people aren't dismissing the pain. And no, everybody here, we're going to say like, oh, we're radical and we conscious, so we know this. But we ain't that damn radical. We've been living in this same culture that everybody else has been living in, and we have all still internalized white supremacy. We have still internalized anti-blackness and xenophobia. We still appropriate indigenous and native culture as products. We still do all these things that we need to be aware of. The next person I'm going to bring up to speak is a young woman who is a warrior named Tina Gonzalez. And she is a member and the Minister of Defense for the Indigenous People's Liberation Party. And she is a powerful speaker and a sister who can take care of her damn self. And so...
Thank you. Hello, everybody. My name is... can everybody hear me?
Yeah, we're good?
Okay. My name is Tina Gonzalez. I'm the Subcomandante for Chicana Defense. It's an all-female-led militant organization for the destruction of machismo. Does everybody know what machismo is? Together, okay, good. So I grew up with a very racist mother. She was the kind of woman that everybody hates because she would see a black person walking by and lock the door to her car, right? Or see a black person going on the street and run inside really fast. And everything that I saw, it wasn't black people doing bad things. It was black and brown communities that were living in poverty. It was going to a welfare office every month with my mom trying to get some extra food, and only black and brown people there, while white people were at Whole Foods buying $18 bags of rice. Excuse me? It's 99 cents at Walmart. Anyways, I saw the suffering that the black and brown community were having. I didn't see black people being bad, Mexicans being scared. I saw a big amount of people, the majority amount of people in my community being black and brown and having no power over what we had. The Indigenous People's Liberation Party has brought something different to my life because for once, I don't feel oppressed as a woman in an organization. We in the leftist community, even though we say we are completely equal rights for males and females, it's not true. It's not true. Males are the ones that do the speeches. This is what happens this way. The Indigenous People's Liberation Party say it's enough. We're done with machismo. We're done with white supremacy. We're done with patriarchy. And we're done with capitalism. Martin Luther King said, our lives begin to end the day we become silent about what matters. We are not silent. Yes, there's not a lot of us out here today, but I want everybody here to be as loud as fucking possible. We are in downtown Dallas, and there's a lot of white people living in the buildings. Put your hands in the air. Put your fists in the air. Swing up for Cooper. When our black and brown communities are under attack, what do we do?
Fight back!
Fight back!
When our brothers and sisters are getting killed on a weekly basis, what do we do?
Fight back! Fight back!
When Darren Gardner was choked to death, and I watched the video of him taking his last breath, when that happens in our community, guys, what do we do?
Fight back! Fight back!
people and by stereotypical bullshit. What do we do?
Stand up, fight back!
What do we do?
Stand up, fight back!
What?